Is this thing working? Can you hear me? Yes. All right. Last year I stood up here and blocked the screen for half the people on this side of the room. So if anybody doesn't have any objections, I'm just going to walk the floor this year and not screw up everybody on this side. I want to thank the David and his mother Susan. And got to stop smoking cigarettes. For having me back this year, thank you very much. And what you guys do, I heard last night the whole story of how this conference came to be what it is today, starting off with that very tiny little budget a long time ago in the first conference. And so thanks again for having Taryn and I back. And I want to thank the nice people who own this real estate from a long way back for having us back and letting us stay in that fancy house on the hill. We appreciate it. I'm not sure why I picked this for an opening. I got a stick in my mouth. It's usually my foot. So anyway, I'm also here with Taryn, so if anybody has any questions after I talk, feel free to ask Taryn or I. We both work together in Africa now in Mongolia, and then we have projects in the United States as well. Typically, if you've, a show of hands, who was here last year and heard me talk? Good Lord, I'm going to need you to laugh at the same jokes for the people who weren't here. typically, the way I do it, I like people to ask questions. If you don't mind, interrupt me midstream. I don't care. Just put your hand up, ask your question, blurt it out. If I don't see your hand, usually will result in much more interesting talk. Anything I can do to make it more interesting, I'm all there. So again, please don't hesitate to put your hand up during the talk anytime. That's me in Africa. I started the Human Food Project, which is a project. It's now moving to a nonprofit status. It's been in existence for I don't know how long, but it's basically a blog. Now we raise money and we collaborate with New York University, Stanford University, University of California, San Diego, University of Colorado at Boulder, and a bunch of other places that are listed on the website. So we're moving into 501c3 status now to try to raise more money to increase the groundwork that we've laid so far to today. But to get to the point where I am today has been very hard and very expensive, and those two things. So they're very fun. Okay, sorry I missed your talk earlier, Monica, and I'm sorry I missed the first night. I think Monica focuses on the front end of the GI tract. Where you at, Monica? Talks a lot about the small intestine. I pretty much focus on the back end. Anybody that doesn't know, that thing's about 30, 35 feet long, meaning the whole thing, for small intestine and the colon. I focus kind of on the last 3 to 5 feet, depending on your age. And I focus on the bacteria in there. And the reason I focus on that is because it's a little unethical these days to stick a probe into somebody's small intestine and pull the microbes out. But people go to the bathroom every morning and they give us kind of a summary, if you will, of what's on the back end. And through other kinds of means, you're able to kind of use that as a diagnostic of what else is going on, including what's going on in the small intestine. I'm not going to talk about a lot of medical jargon today. I'm not going to quote a lot of research things. It's boring. So I'm just going to try to make it interesting and fun and kind of all shucks. And so if anybody wants any more technical information about what I'm talking about, you can email me or ask me later, or a lot of that stuff's on the blog. You can go to PubMed and look it up yourself. So again, that's the colon on the back end. If you don't already know, that we all carry about several pounds of bacteria in our GI tract. It weighs about the same as the human brain. If you removed all the bacteria from your body, you'd be dead in a very short period of time. Life would be very, very miserable. So we've all heard of E. coli. E. coli 0157 is that little bad one out in California in the Salinas Valley that gives Burger King and everybody a lot of trouble. But there's more E. coli in your gut right now than there are people on the earth. And it's always been that way. Most strains of E. coli are benign. They don't do anything. It's not until you get bad strains or you allow the bad strains that you have to bloom upwards that you then have a problem. And again, talking about Monica, the small intestine, if you could take a teaspoon of material out of the small intestine, contains about 50 million bacteria. You do that same teaspoon on the back end in the colon, it contains about 10,000 times that amount. You can put a billion bacteria on a tip of a pen. So think about your last bowel movement, which was 50% microbes. If you remove the water, the dry matter that's left is microbes. You poop microbes in corn, obviously. So so when you read on a yogurt packet, 5 billion cultures in this yogurt, you know, or 5 billion in this, or 5 billion in that, that's a couple of pinheads. It's nothing when you think about a bowel movement, all right? This is going to take a long time. Okay, any two humans you pick have 99.9% identical genomes, even those two yahoos, all right? So we're basically all the same. However, two different little E. coli, their genomes can be as much as 40% different, okay? We can now predict with 90% certainty whether somebody's obese or lean looking at their microbes, but you can't do it looking at their genes, meaning their human genes, okay? So you're not as beautiful and unique snowflake after all. So because our microbes, not a single person in this room statistically probably has a similar set of gut bacteria than the, you know, sitting person next to you. But again, you're 99.9% similar. And that may be at the end we're going to talk about later. Okay? It's a very diverse ecosystem in there. Lots of niches, lots of different nutrient requirements. We're more related to dinosaurs and sharks than some of the bacteria are to each other in our gut. That shows you how desperate that environment is. It's like putting a wolf and a rabbit nose to nose. Okay? Very different species, very different opportunities for those species, very different things going on with those species. Everybody's in it for themselves. They're not in it for each other, but there is a lot, quite a bit of symbiotic activity, though. I just love that. Okay, so how human are we? So, there we are, human, moving quickly here. So, we now know, roughly, give or take, like 9 out of the 10 cells in the human body are microbial. So, you're more microbe than mammal. And so, in this anthropocentric world that we live in, that we were brought up in, both from a scripture standpoint as well as all the textbooks and the way that we think about ourselves, we think about ourselves as being dominated by the genes given to us by mom and dad, when in fact, 99.999% of the genes in our body, the genes are what tell the microbes what to do, and they tell our body what color our hair should be and how many freckles we have and so on and so forth. The vast majority of the genes in the human body are microbial. Again, we're more microbe than mammal, and that's had a dramatic effect on the way that we think about medicine, how our body processes medicine, how our body processes nutrients, and it's redefining self. Okay? So we're moving beyond that anthropocentric view that we inherited what we have from mom and dad, and we're stuck with what grandma and mom and dad gave us, when in fact we can actually manipulate it considerably. And we now know that those 99.999% microbial genes actually control and pull a lot more levers than we ever thought. Not that your own genes aren't important, but they're probably not as important, and that couldn't have been said 3 years ago, not as important as the genes in your microbes. So, anybody that reads this boring literature will know, have noticed that since 2000, there's been a skyrocket in the amount of publications on PubMed about the microbiome. And I showed this graph last year. I think in 2014, I think that number's up around 3,800 or something. It's extraordinary. It's extraordinary. And most of you guys know, if you read a newspaper or a magazine or watch television, watch NPR next week, I'm on it. Actually, it's... what's that public television program? PBS. Yeah, I'm on PBS, if you guys catch it. I hadn't seen it. I'm on it with Michael Pollan. They came to Africa, and they followed me around and watched me collect poo and stuff. It's going to be embarrassing. But if somebody watches it, Taryn and I don't own a television, so somebody sees it and figures out how to tape it or send me an MPEG or something, or I'll send you, a bag of Cheerios or something. I don't know. They did it. What they did is they took Michael Pollan's book, In Defense of Food, and turned it into a 2-hour documentary. And I know Michael, and we've sequenced Michael's bacteria and stuff, and he said, hey, you should go to Africa with Jeff. So these 6 yahoos showed up in Africa and hung out for a week and all got sick and heat stroke, and it's great. And so, but they were able to film me a couple of days. And so I assume it's called In Defense of Food. I don't know. But it's supposed to be on PBS. Michael emailed me, said it was really cool, and they left in the funny parts and all that kind of stuff, so I don't know. So, but again, it was shot almost 2 years ago, so I have no idea. My hair is grayer now. So, again, I'm going to fast forward through a lot of microbe stuff. This is a well-educated audience, and I think everybody here is kind of dialed into what's going on in the food chain as well as what's going on in your own body. And again, so I don't want to get into a lot of boring stuff, so I'm just kind of make do generalizations and talk about things from a 50,000-foot view. But we now know from all those publications that have been piling up and piling up and piling up that we don't know much, okay? And that's the first thing that researchers will tell you who work with the microbiome. We just don't know. And the reason they say that is because in the early 1990s, the guys who were sequencing the genome, okay, Craig Venter and those guys, promised by now we'd all be, you know, cured of everything. They overpromised to get the billions of dollars needed to fund the research that was needed to begin to even unravel what's wrong with us. And, well, that's never going to happen. But the microbiome researcher is very careful not to overpromise. And a lot of it's done. You guys will see the media headlines all the time. But what we do know are some very basic things that are very important that are building blocks for trying to understand how to manipulate our microbiome into a positive direction that may improve our health and well-being and maybe our behavior at the same time. So some things that are just basic and simple, and this has direct relevance to my life. Both my children were born C-section. I have a type 1 diabetic daughter that Tree, Tree, thanks again for organizing the conference, had mentioned early on. We know that vaginally born breastfed babies and at 4 days, 4 months, and 12 months have this kind of bacteria. A vaginally born bottle-fed baby, okay, has a very different set of bacteria. And we know that C-section babies, whether they're bottle-fed or not, look very different. C-section babies, because they come through the abdomen, they have bacteria or populated with bacteria that look like the mother's skin, okay? And there's now, that work was pioneered by Maria Gloria Dominguez Bello. She's got another last name now, too. But she's also a collaborator on our work in Africa and now in Mongolia. She pioneered that work in Puerto Rico, and now one publication, two, 15, 30, 50, hundreds now, dealing with the vagome, dealing with the baby, dealing with breast milk, dealing with all aspects of delivery mode. And so we know that there's huge trials underway now where they're following large groups of babies, you know, hundreds of babies from day one forward. We now know that we can now connect C-section to potential problems. Okay, it's not a sentence, so to speak, but we know it's an issue. So what Maria also has done is she's developed a technique, which I mentioned last year, I think, that if you're going to have a C-section baby, that what they'll do is they'll roll up a gauze, much like a tampon, they'll insert it in the vaginal canal, and right before birth, they'll pull the gauze out, and when the C-section baby comes out, they put the gauze in the baby's mouth. So now the baby's inoculated with the mother's vaginal microbiome, and then they wipe the baby down with that same gauze. So Maria, starting about 2 years ago, started following a set of mothers in Puerto Rico, 10 mamas that gave C-section no gauze, 10 mamas C-section gauze, and lo and behold, the gauze babies look like vaginal babies. Okay, so you're going to see, and I talked to a midwife here earlier yesterday, you're going to see in the very near future, it's happening now all over the world, people taking matters into their own hands, so to speak. And so it's going to probably become a pretty common practice. But it's not a substitute for reducing C-section rates, which are now 1 out of 3 in America on average, as much as 80% in private hospitals in Brazil and China. It's necessary in a lot of cases. And it was, we think, in ours, but I didn't have the information at the time when my son was born in 1995 to complain. I was scared. I was a parent. I was young. I didn't know. Now I know. So I coach as many people as I can, but it always seems that they still have C-sections with no gauze. And so, anyway, it's probably one of the most important things we can do as a society to get the children on the right track from day one. Again, it's not a problem for everybody, but it is a problem for a lot of babies. We also know from these thousands of articles, again, this is just basic stuff, that the bacteria in the oral cavity is very different than the bacteria that we find in our gastrointestinal tract, which is very different than the vaginal canal, or it's very different in our skin, and what's very different in our noses. This all seems kind of uninteresting, but it's also very important. We also know that no matter what sex you are up in the top, we basically look the same. It doesn't matter if we're talking about hair, oral cavity, gut, skin, or nostril. Okay. We know that it doesn't differ much by sex in the Western world. We'll talk about how it differs in other places. It doesn't differ from day to day too much either. We basically kind of look the same. It fluctuates second by second, minute to minute, depending on how you sample the poo. You can take, we're all adults here, you can take said log, you can sample it all along, you can split it open, it's different everywhere. And so trying to split hairs with each individual samples because they look a little different doesn't get anywhere, so that's why we tend to look at thousands of samples together to try to understand. But we don't change much day to day. And this is over a long period of time. This is 440 days looking at different samples on a palm, right hand and left hand, tongue and gut, the gut being up at the top. You know, it fluctuates. You know, your Prevotella will go up, your Bacteroides will go down, your Ruminococcus will go up, the Ruminococcus will go down. You basically look the same on average. Okay? But geography matters too. So the blue dots, these are stool samples. So we know that the bacteria for people in the United States look different than the bacteria from people from Malawi, which looks more similar than to the U.S. than it does. It looks more similar to Amerindians in Venezuela than it does to the U.S. So geography matters. The plants you're around, the animals you're around, the people you hug and kiss and don't hug and kiss matter. Interestingly, we find in Africa that there's species of bacteria in Africa that share with Amerindians in South America that we've lost in Europe and North America. So through all of that time that's transpired, once they crossed over, if you will, crossed the Bering Strait into South America, they carry those African microbes with them, and they still have them today, but we lost them. I do have them. Hugs are $29.95. Anyway, we see it also changes with age as well. I'm not kidding. Anyway, see it changes as well. We got to raise money. Diesel costs money. Diesel and permits cost money. Anyway, we also see that the bacteria change, you know, that change through life. A newborn baby's bacteria in the first few weeks or months of life looks more like a bear, believe it or not, its simple gastrointestinal system, than it does a human. They don't look very, and they're not very human. They're not human until they, at least from a microbial standpoint, until they stop breastfeeding and start eating good old broth. So anyway, real quickly, some of you guys know we started the American Gut Project back on Thanksgiving 2012. I was in Australia at Bondi Beach. Anybody been to Bondi Beach? I was working, okay. It was at Bondi Beach, and I sitting around, I kept going, I really like to know what microbes I have in my body without submitting them as part of a sample of a project that I'm doing. You know, so if I collect samples from somebody, I can put my own samples in there and have them analyzed as part of a project, but I can't just take my own sample, drop it in the mail, and send it to some lab and have a very detailed, in-depth, consistent report given to me. So I called Rob Knight, who I'd been collaborating with. He's at the University of Colorado Boulder, said, why don't we create a project? So after a lot of pain in the ass, we created the American Gut, we created the American Gut Project. If you add what we raised so far with the money from another campaign, we've raised about $1.3 million in donations, of which 99% of it goes to cover costs associated with analyzing the sample. It's a 100% volunteer project. It's been a royal nightmare, and it was a nightmare last year, and it continues to be a nightmare today, because it's staffed by volunteers, postdocs, graduate students who have real lives and real projects to work on. But we're slowly learning and learning a lot. And we're about to publish our first major paper. There's hundreds of labs involved, 375 authors on the paper. It's an extraordinary undertaking that a couple of Yahoos created from nothing 2.5 years ago. So I encourage people, if you haven't already, if you're still waiting on a sample and waiting on analysis, it's coming soon, hopefully. But if you haven't signed up for American Gut, please do. We need your poo. You donate $99 and we send you a kit. You send it back in. We tell you what's inside. And you fill out some very important metadata for us, age, gender, antibiotic use, where you live, well water, city water, dogs, cats, you name it. It's all in there. We keep expanding the questions. And I'll talk a little bit about the American Gut today, but a lot of it we can't talk about because it's under review, it's about to be published, and I'll get in trouble with my co-authors if I mention too much of it. Again, American Gut is, importantly, it's open data, open access, open source. Any scientist in the world, so if you send us a poo sample and we sequence it, we'll put that data in a huge data set called GitHub. Okay, we de-identify it so nobody knows who you are, but they know you're a female, they know that you live here and you eat this and you this age and so on and so forth, so that any scientist in the world can have the data. Okay, nobody's ever done this before. Everybody holds on to their data, nobody wants to share it. We share it. It's open access to any microbiologist in the world, okay? And so we hope it all moves that way. And what we want to do is there's going to be some smart lady in some lab somewhere who's working on her graduate degree that has an aha moment that all of these really smart people didn't see, and that's what we're hoping for. And it's already happening. This is kind of a generic summary of what the report looks like you get. There's Michael Pollan's poo over here on the right-hand side. As you can see, Michael falls kind of in the middle here on his poo sample based on his age and so on and so forth and how he compares to some other populations. Michael, in this particular case, interestingly enough, is dominated by the genus Bacteroides. I can tell you that Michael eats meat, okay? But interestingly, Michael has very high levels of Bacteroides, which Michael doesn't eat enough fiber. He does now, but at that time he didn't. Also, what we're learning is, I don't know if you guys remember, there was called the Human Microbiome Project. It was a couple years ago, cost hundreds of millions of dollars, thank you, of tax dollars. And what that looked at was, it looked very in-depth at about 200 college-age students, okay, healthy college-age students. And healthy was based on BMI, age, IBD, diabetes, things like that. They were, in theory, healthy. But it was very in-depth, cost hundreds of millions of dollars. But what we've learned with our little old goofy crowdfunded crowdsource project, which is extraordinary, now OTUs is what scientists call species, okay? because bacteria are changing their shapeshifters. They change all the time. So, you know, one day they look like this, one day they look a little different because they exchange genetic material with each other all the time, and they're mutating and changing, and they breed like bacteria. So they're mutating every 10 to 15 minutes or growing or creating offspring. But what we've learned in the American Gut Project is what we knew from the $100 million project, that the total number of species that the average American carried, that's what we thought. But we now see that the average Americans carry a huge range, okay? When you get over to 1,000 species here, that's looking like a Hadza hunter-gatherer, okay? But the average American, we now know, is carrying about 400 to 500 different species or O2Us of bacteria. And that doesn't mean strains. You carry thousands and thousands of different strains, but that's kind of at the species level. You can keep splitting hairs and splitting hairs and splitting hairs. So that's been actually kind of fascinating and exciting to see as well. We also used to think that nobody had the same microbiome. Nobody. Okay? We were as unique as snowflakes. And that was based on the Human Microbiome Project. We now know that when we get to about 2,000 samples, two of them are just about identical. Okay? 4,000 samples, statistically, two people, you know, so on and so forth. So there could be two people in this room that share the same microbiome. Okay? So that was exciting too. And so I'll talk a little bit. I'm sorry?
Not of the same family.
No. Parents look more like their dogs than they do their kids. that was an article published in Eli. Sorry?
What about lovers?
Yeah, it depends on time spent together. Yeah, so cohabitating individuals, the longer you spend together, you know, you share the same food, same bed, bodily fluids, so on and so forth, you start looking more and more similar. So yeah, there's a bunch of data out on that. So you look more like the person that you hang out with. And if you have, interesting enough, there's a study that's unpublished, lesbians and homosexual couples, interesting enough, look more similar. Of course, two women would look more similar than a man and a woman after spending a long period of time together. So a lot of that's not surprising, but fascinating. This is one of those weird graphs that you see in a peer-reviewed journal, but I just wanted to show what one of the things that we're learning from American Gut is that people who have taken antibiotics in the last week, which is that red line, have less diverse bacteria. That's that red line right here. Have less diverse bacteria than people, let's say, took them a year ago. In other words, your diversity drops when you take antibiotics, and it's most pronounced immediately after the antibiotics. So again, you guys have read about that, you heard about it, but we're now verifying a lot of clinical data with mass crowdsourced data as well. So the point being is that we might be able to get it clinical things by just doing crowdsourcing. Okay, so in other words, it's cheaper, faster, quicker, not as accurate, but it'll get you that aha moment and it'll kind of get you going in the direction you wanted to go. Yes, ma'am?
Have you
been
studying about herbal antivirals?
Not that I know of. One of the other things we're learning from American Gut, I showed this graph last year, but now we've updated it with thousands of more samples, if you will, so to speak, that we know that as you get older, you have a more diverse microbiome. There were some early studies that indicated as you got older, the diversity dropped. Started taking drugs, not the good drugs, but you started taking medications when you hit 40, 50, or 60, and that kind of blunted, if you will, the diversity. But we now know from looking at larger sets of data, a lot more data points, that as you get older, and we see this in the Hadza hunter-gatherers, your diversity tends to increase, but sometimes not necessarily in a good way. Inflammatory bowel disease. People who have Crohn's and colitis typically have less diverse microbiomes. Now they're trying to untangle whether or not, and this again just is kind of supporting the clinical research that's already shown, does the Crohn's cause the drop in diversity or does the drop in diversity cause the Crohn's? And I can tell you the latter is probably what's going to shake out in the long run. Body mass index, if you're big, you typically have a less diverse microbiome than if you're normal weight, but also underweight people, skinny little people we all hate, tend to have not hate, but you know what I'm talking about, have less diverse microbiomes than normal and just people that like to eat. Exercise frequency. Ben, you in the room? Ben didn't make it. All right. Ben's probably way over here with a lot of diversity, that crazy, crazy marathon thing, whatever. It cracked me up yesterday when he asked. Was anybody here when Ben talked? He said, who in here runs triathlons? Everybody's like, who runs triathlons? Are you kidding me? Taryn and I drove here from the hotel on the hill. So anyway, People that never exercise, you ought to have your ass whipped and you should get out and do something, but it's going to do a lot of good for your microbiome. Just get out and walk around a little bit like Ben said yesterday. Sleep, this is fascinating. This is one of the most interesting things I've ever seen in microbiome research, in my opinion. This is fascinating. People who sleep basically 7 or 8 hours a night have more diverse microbiomes. Tara and I ran into a sleep researcher, interestingly enough, in Namibia. We were in Namibia in January. We were at the Nainai Conservancy, where the San Bushmen are. We were just out of nowhere, ran into a researcher from UCLA. He was out studying. He was putting these crazy watches on the San Bushmen that could tell if they were in a shade tree, if they were laying down, if they weren't moving their body. So whether or not they were sleeping or napping or whatever. And he said, looking at data points from the San Bushmen, he also looked at the Hadza hunter-gatherers, which I didn't know about, and then he looked at another group. He said, on average, and the argument is always we don't sleep enough. You know, we need 8, 9, 10 hours. Einstein slept 12 hours a night. What else do you need to know? All right? Average hunter-gatherer of the ones that he sampled, okay, of course they live in a little bit of modern world. They got Coca-Cola and cell phones and all this other kind of stuff. But I can tell you, living with the Bushmen in East Africa, you get up before daylight because the birds start chirping and they won't shut up. So you get up, and at night it's boring unless you're drinking and you stay up late. If you're not drinking, you go to bed. So the average hunter-gatherer sleeps 7 hours a night. 7 hours a night. So his argument is going, he's a world-class sleep researcher, and I think he was miffed that I didn't know who he was. And so he suggests that we overemphasize sleep in our culture. I don't know the difference between good sleep, bad sleep, REM sleep. He just said sleep. Yes, ma'am? Yeah, couldn't tell you. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
That must have been really interesting, taking stool samples from the Bushmen. They must have been like, what is this crazy?
Yeah, I'll talk about some of that crazy stuff here at the end. Yeah. So the San Bushmen, we're not sampling, but I'm going to talk about at the end. We're about to do a project with them. But anyway, fascinating. 7 hours of sleep, you're good. This may be the second most interesting thing. This is a question I fought very hard to get into the metadata with American Gut. Has anybody filled out this survey before? Is anybody in this room? Okay, this is absolutely unexpected by every microbiologist on the planet. There's not a single person that could have predicted this, okay? It's like me. And I said it was true, and I argued, but I'm a goofball anthropologist, what do I know? And so this is one thing that I smiled about very bigly over the last 6 months or 2 years as we collected this data, is people that eat more species of plants, and I don't mean spices, you know, I mean bell peppers, onion, garlic, whatever. People that eat more diversity of plants have a greater diversity, and diversity is important, we're going to talk about that later, greater diversity of gut bacteria. Okay, this is profound. Now, why this is interesting, we can put this into play today. Today. I always tell people, start Monday morning, get your little pad, write down what plants you eat all week. It's a pain in the ass, but write it down. Don't cheat, and you'll see the average American eats only 5 species of plants a week. Okay, potatoes, iceberg lettuce, tomatoes, carrots, things like that. But if you can get up around 30, 40, the average Whole Foods store carries a little over 150 to 200 different species of plants. Okay? Yes, ma'am? Yeah, but drink the whole thing. Yeah, but you're also better off letting your stomach do some of it. If you do too much pre-digestion, or it's called extrasomatic, then your body's not working hard enough. It's not burning enough calories. So you should let your body do as much of the work as you can. But then there's that argument that if you break down the cellular walls, you free more of the nutrients. So 6 one way, half a dozen the other. Maybe Vitamix one day, which are expensive, and then maybe not Vitamix the next day or whatever. But just if you eat plants, who cares how you eat them, okay? But play around with this. And if you guys, you also know bowel habit will increase. You want floaters, not sinkers, and all the other kind of good stuff. So, so this again, this is American Gut data. And so what we're interested in is big data. We want 20,000, 40,000, 50,000 people in the study. And we see that people that have been admitted to ICU for whatever reason whatsoever, typically when they're sampled, doesn't matter what they have different microbiomes than the general population. Okay? So this is the point where they actually hadn't taken any medication. Okay? Something's going on with them, and their microbiome shifted. Okay? That's the blue. These are people in ICU. These are just the American gut data. These are poo samples. Yeah. It's just interesting. Nobody, you know, so as we move along and move along, so the American gut data, which is self-collected data, is not great data, but it may inform us in directions that may say, hey, maybe we should develop a clinical trial to look at this based on all these really nice people who joined the crowdsourcing project. So in other words, it helps create hypothesis testing and things like that. So it's absolutely fascinating. Again, here's some kind of tidbits. The microbes on your hands are very distinct from others, on average, at least 85% different in terms of species diversity. So we all have very different microbes on our hand because we all wipe our butt differently, we eat different things, we have different kids with snotty noses, non-snotty noses, lovers, friends, you name it. I shaked Webb's hand earlier, no telling what I got on my now. Anyway, our mouth microbes may even help regulate blood pressure. So these are just kind of just little interesting tidbits. There's hundreds of them, okay? Microbially speaking, we start off looking more like a bear, blah, blah, blah. We've learned that the gut microbe communities that are lower in diversity have been associated with obesity, inflammatory bowel disease, and rheumatoid arthritis. That's a long way or short way of going about saying all autoimmune disease, all bowel disease, and all diseases of inflammation. That's pretty much everything. So the writing's on the wall, and as every scientist who works with the microbiome will tell you, we've got a long way to go. Let's not oversell this, but it really is interesting and fun and exciting. Are the bugs going to be responsible for everything? No. Do they play a causal role in some things? Probably. Is it going to be a single species? Probably not. It's not going to be that easy, you know. But anyway, it's very interesting. And so the more attention we pay to our microbiome as individuals, the more ready we're going to be when this information starts to come out in kind of clinical form, if you will, and possibly diagnostic form. Lots of people, lots of diversity, but are Westerners the best population to study? And I just noticed this morning. What is that? is that like Planet of the Apes? I just saw that. I don't know what the hell that is. But anyway, this is kind of a summary of a couple of thousand American gut samples. And this is at the phylum level. Again, those of you who don't know the tree of life, phylum, you know, it's phylum, you know, and it goes all the way down to it's class order, whatever, it goes down to genus and species. So kind of from a 50,000-foot view, it's kind of like going to Walmart parking lot and saying you have Fords, Chevys, and so on and so forth. So this is the Ford and Chevys, if you will, which are the Firmicutes, the Bacteroides, Protozoa. These are the large groups or phylum of bacteria. And we see that, see, this is me over here. On this particular sample, I had 75% Firmicutes, okay, the red ones, whereas Michael Pollan over here only had 30%. Whereas Shannon Ford, who was Miss America, she was married, is it MRS, Miss MRS, Miss America at the time, she's also a paleo eater. She looked like that. But the point is we all fall along a spectrum. You may have a lot of Firmicutes, you may have none, okay? I can flip mine overnight. We used to think that people with a lot of Firmicutes were obese, but that was 5-10 years ago. That no longer holds. I can flip my Firmicutes from 90% to 10% just like that, and so can any of you. And we'll talk about, who knows? These are early days. We need more samples. We need more research. We need more NIH money. So the point is that we're all over the place, but the question, should we be all over the place? Should we be here during the summer, there during the winter? Here is a female, there is a male, here is a teenager, here is some old guy like Doug. just kidding, Doug. I love you, brother. You know that. All right, so if these guys with Planet of the Apes isn't a good population to study, and I argue that the reason we study Westerners is because it's easy. You can put an ad in a newspaper and say, I'll give you $50, you come poo in a dish. You're like, sign me up. That's how they recruit those people, all right? And we say we need people that are this big, we need people this small, we need blacks, whites, Chinese, Texans, whatever it may be. $50, come poo in a dish, or whatever it may be. And the problem is, I would argue, because all of us in America drink the water, that means chlorine and fluoride. That's a big one, and we're working on that. Some of us have been exposed to antibiotics, some of us have been exposed to antibiotics and hormones, I mean, you name it. We're all compromised. I don't care. Every single person in this room is compromised. Even healthy David over there, he's compromised. Yes, ma'am.
My understanding
is that
Americans are the biggest users of toilet paper in the world.
That's great. I got to write that down. Yeah. It's a big one because, like most people in Africa, they, It was alarming to me the first time I discovered this, because we hired a cook to work for us in Tanzania, and he was washing our dishes and chopping our produce and stuff, and the nicest man in the world got a cigarette hanging out of his mouth with a big ash on it while he's chopping. One of those guys got the wife beater on, and he's doing it, and he's probably 50, 55 years old, and I asked him one day about his bowel habits. And, of course, when we have a camp set up, everybody has their own poo spot, and you got to bury the poo and all that other kind of stuff. And then we collect flies in camp, too. We collect flies and look at their microbiome, because the flies land on the poo. They bring it back to camp, put it on the food, so we collect flies and analyze them and so on and so forth. But anyway, he goes, "Oh, I've been wiping my ass with my hand." And I'm like, "Really?" We got to talk. So anyway, it's interesting. And we see in the Hadza, which I'll talk about. Raise your hand again when I get to the Hadza and ask me about babies and hands and bifidobacterium. But yeah, it would be very different. Probably if it weren't, you're in a Western world. So in other words, maybe 1,000 years ago, wiping your hand with your butt 1,000 years ago probably wouldn't have been as bad a deal. But today we're pooping out a lot of different microbes than we did maybe 1,000 years ago. So wiping our butt with our hands now and then touching each other might not be such a great thing. But I don't know. It's a good question. Yes, sir.
You're making the assumption that the fecal bacteria is the same as small intestinal bacteria.
Oh, yeah. Good question. Yeah, good question. Great question. So again, 35 feet of pipe, okay, teaspoon, 50 million bacteria on the front end, teaspoon on the back end, 10,000 times that amount. So the bacteria in the small intestine, because the pH changes throughout the small intestine, all these little ecological niches, the problem is what the poop on the back end tells us about the back end of the colon, okay? But what little work has been done, it's starting to be predictive of kind of the whole colon, the proximal end as well, but we know so little about the small intestine. It's breathtaking. That's a great question, because it's unethical or a problem with IRBs, institutional review boards, to stick probes in people and to pull the poo out of their small intestines. But it's a huge unknown, and it's a great question.
Can you get somebody, that's where Andrew Wakefield got involved. Can you get somebody to volunteer?
Yeah, people are working on it, but the total number of studies like that are dwarfed by the, and what's happening now is the poo, which is the tail end of every, an average of everything, if you will, at the back end, and the pH down there is becoming a little bit predictive. So in other words, maybe you can predict what's going on in the small intestine without having to do that. So probably 10, 20 years away from that, but who knows. But they might develop a technique. They're doing it now with the little all the way up and taking the sample and coming all the way back down. They got the pills you swallow that gobble up the microbes. They got pills you can swallow with a string on them to sample your stomach bacteria. You pull the string back out. I haven't done this yet. I'm excited about trying it. Because I want to know if I have H. pylori. Okay, which has been associated with ulcers and some other inflammation. Are you getting ready to raise your hand? All right. So again, Planet of the Apes, the beer drinkers, maybe not be the best guys to study. None of you either. All right. So I started asking this question a couple years ago, and again, I started saying, well, why isn't anybody out running around in East Africa and stuff? Why is anybody? So there's a few people. There's a woman, Maria Gloria Dominguez Bello, Blazer, the woman who did the work in Puerto Rico, who's a collaborator. I'd contacted her many, many years ago and said, you know, she was working in Venezuela at the time. She was working with minimally contacted groups. And I said, look, we should go to Africa. And she said, you know, let's go. So anyway, so we started trying to put projects together back in 2009, 2010. Very difficult to get permits because you have a lot of bioethics rules in Africa. There's a lot of people going to Africa. They collect blood and people, it's weird and stuff. And so, but we're collecting poo. So anyway, there's a precedent there. There's a precedent of abuse there, if you will, with regards to indigenous groups.
We're doing poo implants for C-diff-resistant
people. Right.
Obviously, the poo that's working for those kind of people with C-diff
problems. Right. Well, I was talking about permits, getting permits to work. What was the question?
Well, they're doing poo implants
yeah.
for people with
fecal microbiota transplants.
Yeah. Bacteria. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, no, that's a good point. Yeah, but I think what I was getting at earlier, like 6-7 years ago, it's just difficult to get permits just to conduct the research, you know, without even getting into good details like you just talked about. So working in Africa was a problem for people. The permits that we got in Tanzania, somebody tried to get them before, they couldn't get them. So anyway, so we said, let's go to Tanzania. So starting a few years ago, we started, this is a hunter-gatherer. That stick in his hand, he's going to make into a bow. That nice hair piece is zebra, okay? So anybody been to Tanzania? Anybody hung out with the Hadza? You guys have? Okay. Who'd you go with? Okay. Was you didn't see the Hadza? The Hadza hunter gatherers? Yeah, who'd you go with? Who took you, though? Who took you out? Okay. I was just curious if it was DeRobo. All right, this guy's been a National Geographic more times than I can count. That's zebra meat around that bad man right there. This is a guy named Asaya. He's a camp boss at one of the camps that we work at. But we work with the Hadza hunter-gatherers. Now, every hunter-gatherer in the world, minus the uncontacted groups, are compromised. Okay? This man owns a cell phone. Okay? This man has access to processed flour, Coca-Cola, marijuana on a daily basis. Thank God. And that, by the way, is stomach hanging on him there. This is part of his cut from the zebra kill. He's taking it home with him. So he's exposed to the Western world. So anthropologists fight each other all the time. Well, you can't study the Hadza hunter-gatherers and use them as a referent, a modern referent for early human evolution because they have L.A. Laker t-shirts and they have metal pots. And all this stuff is true, but depends on the question you're asking of them. And I made this point last year. What we wanted to know is how does a free-living population who still lives in the dirt, okay, still lives in the dirt, whose babies are born in the dirt, okay, who still hunt and have this intimate connection with the blood and the feces and the urine and the stomach contents of all these animals on the landscape, who have minimal or variable exposure to antibiotics, okay, and can we tease these things out? What do they look like? You know, not the guys hanging out with Planet of the Apes, but what do these guys look like? These guys probably because we spent, again, I'm not sure where you stand on evolution, but if you buy the idea that we've evolved in East Africa, possibly South Africa, as Lee Berger has his way, you know, for over millions of years, and our adaptive and our innate immune system evolved on this landscape, okay? The Hadza live in a part, I mean, they're literally walking on Homo erectus, Zinjanthropus, they're walking on the bones, if you will, of Australopithecus. They hunt the same animals. They drink almost the same water. They're covered in the same soil. They follow the same seasonal patterns. So there might be an interesting group to look at, okay? Definitely more so than people living in St. Louis, okay? So we put a project together. That's Lake Eyasi, okay, which is a large lake that they live by. Here's the Hadza about, I don't know, 90 years ago, okay? Anthropologists have been working with the Hadza for a long time. These are not uncontacted people. There's a large group of anthropologists that moved through there, and they have been moving through there for almost 100 years, and a lot since the 1970s, okay? So they have continuous exposure to researchers, and the Hadza are spread over a huge area, okay? Some Hadza receive as many as 5,000 visitors a year, tourists, okay, who give, like you went hunting with the bush baby. You probably went to camps right around Gorfani and Barazani and so on and so forth, okay? You probably went to Misafiri's camp. Do you remember the name? Okay. So they have lots of exposure, which is a good and a bad thing. But some Hadza live farther out, and some even farther out, and some even farther out. So we look at all the groups. So we can study Hadza hunter-gatherers who have a lot of exposure to tourists, and some don't have as much exposure to tourists, okay? And so on and so forth. These are just a few quick slides. This is a Hadza hunter-gatherer going up a baobab tree. These guys love them some honey. Okay, so during the rainy season, there's basically 6 months of dry, 6 months of rain. During the rainy season, lots of flowers, lots of bees, lots of honey. So there's days the Hadza will eat thousands and thousands and thousands of calories of honey. I myself have consumed 10, 15,000 calories and barfed. And so these guys eat a lot of honey. It would make any nutritionist crazy, the amount of honey that these guys eat. This is a guy named Shabubu. I just like saying that. This is his cut on a zebra kill. Again, intimate exposure to the microbes on the zebra, which we're very interested in, the blood, the feces, and so on and so forth. He's a good dancer, too, by the way. Some Hadza hunters. Here's some baboons. This is an impala. Again, zebra kill. And there's my lovely partner, Taryn, going, what are we doing? Besides animals, the Hadza kill and can name about 700 or 800 species of animals and plants. The vast majority of those are birds. Okay, the big hunter-gatherers kill a lot of little bitty birds. Okay, they also eat a lot of berries. They also eat a lot of baobab fruit, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. They also eat a lot of tubers. Here's some Hadza women digging tubers. This is the primary nutrition and food source for the women, and it always has been and continues to be. Baobab is the primary of all the species of plants that they harvest and all the species of animals that they kill. Baobab fruit, which is it has this fat and this fiber in it, they get more calories from that one species than all the other ones considered. There's a guy up in a tree eating some berries, which are very seasonal. Again, I'm just going to flip through some slides really quick. This is a large kudu that was killed. They killed lots of kudu, and when I'm around, I film it. I sample their hands before and after the kill. I sample the animals. I sample them, their poo. So we spend a lot of time watching them go through kills and come out of kills. Go through kills and come out of kills. And when you get that kill on your hand, then you go home and, excuse me here, and you touch somebody else, they're now part of the kill, okay? That we've lost in our modern society, and that's an important source of bacteria we're going to talk about later. So this is stomach contents. He'll rub his hands on the ground now and get all the bacillus spores and the other bacteria from the dirt in his hands.
Why is it so common then here when we touch
the hands? Yeah, I don't know about that. You guys hush. I don't know. That's a good question. Good question. Yeah, it's complex. It's a good question. These guys get sick too. Okay, not as much though. So on the right-hand side, there they are. Small intestines, feces, blood, it's everywhere. Okay. He's eating a raw piece of stomach and enjoying every bit of it. Now, and I mentioned last year, these guys will eat raw colon. I haven't been there yet. They eat raw colon. They eat raw stomach. And just first time I saw this, I literally sat down and lost my breath. The first time I saw them eat a raw colon. They just take the colon and squeeze all the pellets out of it like an impala and just start eating it like sushi. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. I wrote a note and published a little article in Nature. They couldn't believe it either, so they published it. I mean, nobody had actually ever mentioned this before, even though people had been observing it. So this extraordinary interaction with the microbial community was a game changer for me. I spent years planning to go there, and I finally got there and was not ready to see this happen. I knew it happened, but I was not ready to see it happen. So it was one of these things where you just started connecting the dots when you see things like this. So when he gets done with this, he'll probably lick the knife.
So then if you take his food, then what are you going to see?
Hang on, we'll get to that. No, it just tastes good.
Yeah,
it's a lot. Of course, the colon's fatty. Yes, ma'am. Good question. Average life expectancy, is according to Frank Marlowe, average life expectancy of a Hadza hunter-gatherer is 35 years. It's not, and this is important, if you and I had a baby, it would look good, all right? If you were 30 and I was 30 and we had a baby, okay, you and I together are 60, if you and I had a baby and it died at birth, we now have to divide 3 into 60. So average life expectancy of our family is 20. So that's how life expectancy is figured. It's a crude measure of nothing. Okay? So these guys die average, I think I've seen it written a couple times. The number one cause of death for old men is falling out of trees. They die from simple infections. They die from poison arrows. Babies die, kids die from malaria, childbirth, you know, standard things, okay? But it's not from their diet, okay? They're not dying of cardiovascular disease. They're not dying of cancer. Although nobody studies that very closely with the Hadza, there's not a lot of obesity. You know, when you see obesity, it's usually where they have access to corn, things like that. And so life expectancy there is due to kind of preventable things. Yes, ma'am.
Would you expect that you would get sick?
I'll get to that in just 1 second. Okay, so one of the things we do, again, talked about this last year, we collect poo samples, we give them little tubes, so they're self-collected, which is a problem. Be nice if I held the thing underneath, but, you know, baby steps. And so we give them little cryo tubes, and they'll put the feces in the tube for us, and we freeze it in the field in liquid nitrogen, which, as you guys know, is fun at parties. Keeps the samples really, really cold until we pay somebody $5,350 to ship them to the United States for us. So expensive. So anyway, we freeze everything in liquid nitrogen. This guy's in the back going, what? And so it's a fun game with the Hadza. They like to touch the sticks and stuff and so on and so forth. But anyway, so aside from, this is Rob Knight probably. If anybody wins a Nobel Prize in microbiology, it's either be this guy, believe it or not. Looks like an elderly woman shopping for real estate in Florida. That's Rob Knight. If anybody wins a Nobel Prize in microbiology, it'll be Rob Knight or Jeffrey Gordon. Okay. Rob is probably this by a mile the smartest person I have ever met in my entire life. And anybody that's ever met Rob will tell you the same thing. He's 36 years old. Rob's now at the University of California, San Diego. He invented a lot of the software and a lot of the analytical tools that's used by biologists and microbiologists all over the world. He's just crazy smart, being funny looking. So anyway, so this is Rob. Rob came to Africa. He's part of our collaboration, part of our group. So in addition to taking stool samples, again, we're very interested in hand samples. Look at that hand, okay? Look at that hand. This guy here is not quite sure what we're doing on his forehead, but we do things like forehead, armpits, groins when we can get them. We don't do anything invasive, okay? We're not doing vaginal swabs at the moment. We're not collecting blood at the moment. We're just collecting skin sites and poo, if you will. In addition to some standard stuff, we collect information. Look at our fancy measuring stick, okay? So that's like a stick with a measuring tape on it, taped with duct tape. You do what you can do, okay? So we height, weight, and we collect multiple samples from people over time. So this time series is very important. The same person one day, next day, 1 week later, next season, so on and so forth. We're very interested in families. When we can get mothers with newborns that are breastfeeding, siblings, very important. We have multiple generations. Great-great-grandma, great-grandma, grandma, all the way down. It's absolutely fascinating. These are going to be some of the most informative samples that we've taken to date. This is Sam Smits from Stanford University, probably the smartest graduate student in America. He's got like six kids. I don't know. It's crazy. Anyway, this is Sam. He works in Justin Sonnenberg's lab. If anybody gets a chance, there's three books that are out now. Justin Sonnenberg's book, which they're selling on that table over there, is hands down the best book in the world on the gut right now. Justin and Erica Sonnenberg, they were part of Jeffrey Gordon's lab. It's if you buy any book this year, buy that book. The second book you should buy is Rob's book. It's more of an all shucks because he won't make any commitment to anything. But it's a great review book of what's going on in the gut. It's part of his TED Talk. That's over there. I don't make anything for selling their books. Somebody else is selling them, but they're great books. It's the two books over here. One's called, I think, The Good Gut, and the other one's called Gut Something. There you go. There's one. That is the best book in the world right now for the microbiome. Spend the $20, get it. Just get that book and get Rob's book, okay? Save the money on the Adidas tennis shoes that Ben told you to buy. buy these books, okay? The other book is by Martin Blaser. Marty Blaser was in Africa with us as well. He was just named one of Time's 100 most influential people in the world, whatever the hell that means, I don't know. But Marty's at NYU. He wrote the book Missing Microbes, okay? I cannot recommend it enough. Sell, have a yard sale. If you don't have them, do whatever you got to do to get those three books. We'll do more for your health and well-being, almost as much as bone broth and the other stuff. But get those books. So anyway, height, weight, what'd you eat? Did you have antibiotics? It's very difficult to collect information from Hadza because they don't know how old they are. You look at a guy, and how old are you? He's like, I'm 27. I'm like, dude, you're like 90, you know? And you ask an old woman how old you are. She's like 17, you know. So they don't know when they're born. It's hard, and so we work with interpreters. We work with Hadza who speak English and Swahili. So it's very difficult. So when somebody says they're 50, we usually say you're plus or minus 10 years. So it's kind of an average, but it's clearly an older man and a younger man and an infant. They typically know how many seasons the child's been around, two seasons, three seasons, things like that. So it's very difficult to collect this information. It's also very difficult to collect information on antibiotics. Have you had any Western medications in the last week? No. 2 seconds later, have you had any Western medications last week? Yes. I mean, so it's very difficult. So we have to tease this information out. Subsequently, some of it may be incorrect. So we have large samples, so we get rid of that noise, hopefully. Yes, sir. We have because of our IRB, so we have permits from the Tanzanian government, from the Ministry of Health, an ethics approval. We have ethics permits from Puerto Rico, NYU, and Colorado. So we also have a thing called a consent form. So when we started the project, we get large groups of people around. We explain the project in Swahili as well as Hadzabi, which is their native language. We explain the project to them, and then they have to give informed consent. Okay, typically in the form of a thumbprint, which we did early on. So most of them want to participate. Some of them don't. They all want money. Okay, a lot of them have seen cameras out. You know, they're like BBC, CNN, and the crews pay them. Okay, there's a hilarious story. There's a bunch of Hadza sitting on a rock, and they're like, and they're talking in Swahili and, or in Hadzabi, actually. And it looks like they're talking about hunting, you know, an impala or whatever. And the film crew's filming them or whatever. And then the interpreter, who spoke English and Hadzabi, they asked the interpreter, well, what are they talking about? Are they talking about, like, hunting an impala or a kudu? And they said, no, they're asking about whether or not they think you guys have any marijuana. So anyway, informed consent is what we have to get with everybody. And some of them don't want to participate. And they want to be paid, so we're not allowed to do that. So what we often bring with us, Taryn and I and the other people we work with, we bring congas for women. We bring pots, pans. We bring knives for the men. These guys cold hammer projectile points out of, like, nails and stuff. There's a group of people there called the Datoga, which look, if you guys are familiar with the Maasai, they look a lot like the Maasai, except they wear purple instead of red. They have the ability to make arrowheads, and they trade the hides of meat and stuff. So we give them things they can use. We don't give them food, okay? Sometimes we do. It's usually on the way out the door kind of thing. Sometimes we do. We hire some Hadza to work in our camp with us. It's kind of protocol. And sometimes we won't sample them, but they're given, they eat some of the, you know, they eat rice and beans and things like that. And good Lord, these guys can eat. You can take a plate this big and put rice, they'll eat the whole thing. They just assume they're not going to get any more. So it's extraordinary to watch how much food these guys can eat, especially the men. Why do they want what? Why does anybody want marijuana? Why do you smoke it? These guys are the worst pot growers on earth, by the way. So what they do is they trade for weed with the Datoga. They trade honey, meat, things like that. The men will smoke weed all day long if you give it to them. All day long. They'll smoke it. I mean, if they get it. They'll smoke it all day long. It's terrible weed, by the way. You got to smoke a sack of it to get high, I hear. Yeah. All right, again, just going through some pictures. We sample the water. We're very interested in the water, okay, because they share an environment with some guys, some pastoralists who have cows. So we sample the cows. The pastoralists have donkeys. We sample the donkeys. We don't know which bacteria in the cows, and then the cows shit in the water. And it changes seasonally, so we sample seasonally. We want to know all the microbes in the community, okay, because that's where the Hadza get their microbes, just like us. We get our microbes from our community, as well as the people we cohabitate with, as well as the foods we eat and don't eat. So there's the real estate lady from Florida, again, sampling poo. That's a first for Rob. Here we're sampling water, and again, we sample during zebra kills and impala kills and so on and so forth. There's Marty Blazer. There's a guy, he's part of Collaborate on this project at NYU, the world's leading expert on antibiotics and its impact on the gut microbiome and how it contributes to obesity. There's his lovely partner, Maria Gloria Dominguez Bello Blazer. She's right there. She's a feisty little Puerto Rican. And then there again, real estate lady. There's me. And then there's Sam Smits, and then, again, just collecting data, and we're all very excited about her weight. So, anyway, so real quickly, I showed some of this last year. We're about to publish our first Hadza data. We're going to try to publish in Nature, so it's a high-impact journal. There's a lot of authors on it, and if Nature gets any wind whatsoever that we disseminate any of the information anywhere to anybody, they will not publish the article. So there's a lot of data I will not give you today, but I'll give you some stuff that was already out there and we've already talked about a little bit before. One of the most fascinating things, this has never been documented in any population anywhere in the world, but we knew it would happen. If it rains and you have a rainy season, a dry season, the resources change. There's no honey in the dry season. There's lots of meat in the dry season because the animals aggregate around water holes, so they're easy to kill. So meat consumption goes up for 6 months of the year and it drops for another 6 months of the year. Honey goes up, honey goes down. Berries go up, berries go down. So seasonal shifts because of rainfall dictate what foods they eat and ipso facto what bacteria they should carry. When you look at Americans, for more or less, we look the same year round. Okay, but maybe we should be cycling. Maybe we should be kind of like circadian rhythm. Maybe we should be cycling through seasons. We don't know yet. So this is just wet season and dry season, same people, exact same people. Okay, so the microbiome changes seasonally. Again, real quickly, I showed this last year. Americans or Westerners contain two species of Prevotella. This is a very important genus of bacteria, which you're going to see in the media a lot. Two species, the Hadza carry a lot of them. The question is, when Monica's ancestors, you know, 60,000 years ago when they left Africa, okay, and if she signs up and pays her $100 for National Geographic's Genographic Project, which everybody should do, it's really informative, And by the time you get out of here, you've got to spend $1,000 to stay alive, basically. Got to buy books, got to join National Geographic, Genographic Project. But anyway, when Monica's ancestors left Africa 60,000 years ago, did they have all of these Prevotella? And if so, what happened? Where did they go? Are they important? Should we reintroduce them? These are the questions that we're trying to figure out. Do we want to bottle up Hodza poo and give it to everybody? Hell no. Okay, it's not a good idea. Not that I know of. It's a great idea. That's a good idea. It's a good idea. But we do know that people that leave from, I have a hypothesis. You know, you hear it all the time, this theory that when somebody leaves their native land and the first generation in L.A., they get sick and whatever, and because they now eat McDonald's and KFC and stuff, I think it may have a lot that they've now been removed from the microbial community that's protected them. So that's a variable that nobody's considered in the hygiene hypothesis, so to speak. They've considered parasites and some microbes, but the epidemiologists don't look at microbes and so on and so forth. So anyway, so should Monica still have these? You know, are they protective? Are they useful? Are they worthless? Who knows? So nobody knew this 6 months or a year ago. Nobody knew this, okay? So our little bitty project, we think, can make a contribution. Again, real quickly, males and females. You look at 5,000 Americans, males and females basically look the same. We all overlap, if you will, okay? But we see that the Hodza don't. Females look different than males in terms of the diversity of bacteria that they carry. And it changes with season, okay? And the reason it's this way is because there's a sexual division of labor in hunter-gatherer societies. Women gather predominantly, men hunt predominantly. What do? They kill animals, they eat more protein, more fat, and they eat more honey. The men are the ones who go get the honey. Women sometimes go too, but men get the honey. What is the first thing they do? They think they bring it home to Mrs. Smith. Oh, hell no. They eat it, especially if it's a small amount. If a male kills a small animal, like a hyrax, which looks like an overgrown chihuahua that mated with a rat. I think that is a chihuahua. Anyway, so that's what a hyrax looks like. They kill a lot of hyrax, and if it's just one man or one grown boy, he'll just eat it, okay? But what do the women do every morning? They get up, like they've done, we think, for a long time, and they go out and dig tubers. They got to keep the kids alive. Hunting is risky, doesn't deliver every day, okay? Sometimes you don't find the honey. What's there every day? Tubers. They're in the ground every day. Everybody eats. Everybody eats. So women, their main thing in their diet is starchy tubers, berries, less meat, less honey. Men, it's more meat, more honey, but lots of berries and tubers as well. Sexual division of labor creates different diets, hence different microbiomes. So maybe when I go down to whatever and I look at buying whatever, should it be labeled male and female? I don't know. So when I say whatever, I mean probiotics. Again, real quickly, these are some hand samples. So before butchering impala, so this is a bunch of hand samples from a bunch of people. This is one individual who then butchered an impala, and then I checked his hand an hour later. Now the bacteria, now again, these are PICO plots, principal coordinates plots. And so basically what it means, it's like, you ever take one of those little nativity scenes with the fake snow in it or whatever, or the little German gingerbread, you shake it up and all the snowflakes fall, and you can turn it in three dimension. So basically, the closer the dots are together, the more similar the microbiomes are. Okay, so the farther away, the more dissimilar they are. So after an hour later after butchering an impala, his hand looks totally different. Okay, what do we do all day? We wash our hands, we don't touch anything, we put wet wipes. Unless we hang out with Doug, we don't get a whole lot of stuff on our hands. Okay, so what happens is, again, that blue dot, that hand, goes home and it touches my lovely wife. I'm in the West Room. Just kidding. Anyway, so again, that's fascinating. Nobody's ever documented that before. Hand microbiome changes again. This is somebody butchering an impala after butchering a kudu, 30 minutes after butchering a kudu, harvesting honey. So after somebody harvests honey, the hands don't look really different. Okay? It's animals. Animals. Animals that really change our hands and we think change our microbiomes. So. Nobody knows. Good question. It's a little bit of everything, but it can't hurt. This is fascinating to me. One of the most pushed probiotics in the world, Lactobacillus, okay, and Bifidobacterium. We're all told we need Bifidobacterium. We all need Lactobacillus. Hodza don't have them, okay? It's mainly driven by, now, early on when they're breastfeeding, okay, so this is the relative abundance of Bifidobacterium, but as the child ages and they're weaned, the Bifidobacterium drop off. What do? We wean. Then we move right on to dairy products. Okay? And you can also promote the growth of bifidobacterium with prebiotics as well. But it's just interesting that it drops off. And why that's interesting is like, well, maybe we don't really need bifidobacterium, but we know bifidobacterium are good, and they're good for adults, okay? But the question is when bifido, typically when one thing drops out, something drops with it. We call that a co-occurrence, okay? So, for example, if I leave the room, or if Taryn leaves the room, I go with her, okay? So we leave together. So if the bifidobacterium drop out of the child's gut, are there other bacteria that leave with it, okay? And the answer is, yeah, well, I can't tell you which ones. It's a big part of our paper that we're working on. So it's fascinating that possibly we don't need these bifidobacterium. So,
but we might
need
what
those are. We'll see. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, probably, but nobody knows. Nobody knows. It's a good question, though. Times are changing. This is a, Taryn, you remember his name? I can't remember his name. Anyway, he lives in a place we call Corn Town. It's like a Mad Max town to us, you know. Anyway, this guy, he's a hunter-gatherer. He's got his bow and his poison arrows and his yield of corn, okay? So what this particular guy's done, corn's moved into Hadza land, okay? The government drops it off with an airplane, okay? And the first time I saw this, we saw medical people showing up too. I couldn't believe it. And their argument was that the Hadza needed the food. Okay, first, if you ever ask a Hadza, are you hungry? They're like, yeah, I'm hungry. What do you got? Do they have plenty to eat? Oh, hell yeah. You can walk 100 meters in any direction out of a Hadza camp and find honey from Apis bees, which are the stinging ones, or from the small bees. You can dig up a tuber. I mean, food's everywhere. Baobab, there's food everywhere. But if you ask a hunter-gatherer if they're hungry, they're like, man, I'm starving. So anyway, so the government delivers corn, they plant it, and then these guys still hunt and gather. So they're part-time agriculturalists, part-time hunter-gatherers. Absolutely fascinating to study, okay? So we have groups of these guys in there as well. To plant. Very few Hadza don't like plant. There's a few Hadza that do plant, and then they trade the corn or keep it for themselves or whatever. But this is your microbiome on corn. I showed this last year. It's been modified a little bit. So we had a group of hunter-gatherer, a group of Hadza camp. There was no corn. Okay, there hadn't been corn in the camp for a long time. But then 20 kilograms showed up. Okay, and what do they do when the corn shows up? They sit down. Okay, they don't go out and dig tubers. They don't go out hunting. They eat corn for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Okay, the men will still go hunting. What they do is they boil it, and they make this horrible little meal with it. It's just nasty. But they eat it. So what happens is, so this is a group of individuals in a camp that were 20 kilograms of corn that came in. You can see on January 26, okay, this is Prevotella. This is a very important genus of bacteria. Prevotella, so this is the average relative abundance of the Prevotella. So it's less than 10% of all the bacteria, or a small percentage of the bacteria. But each day as they kept eating corn, the Prevotella kept going up. Okay, and this, I happen to have a Prevotella fetish myself. Prevotella, I would argue, which is a dominant genus of bacteria, it dominates. It could be as much as 50% of all the bacteria in your body is driven by the agriculture revolution. It shouldn't be part of our microbiome. And so this is evidence to that argument. And then we also see that as they eat corn, you have TREP that goes up as well. No, that's actually between seasons, I'm sorry. The distribution of this particular bacteria on the right-hand side, this shouldn't be in here, by the way. Distribution of this particular group of bacteria on this side, which are a good set of bacteria, if you will, they drop with the introduction of corn. Okay, we also see TREP here as well. It drops with the introduction of corn. And then this is an unrelated. Say again? It's been associated with some inflammatory diseases. Including rheumatoid arthritis and some other things. I don't know. There's not a single report that shows that GMO corn has an impact on your microbiome, but nobody's ever studied it either, so probably doesn't. No, I was just saying that Prevotella, which is a huge group, it's a genus, by the way. And remember, there's a bunch of species of Prevotella. There was a paper a couple years ago, a couple of you guys might have seen it. it grouped a bunch of people into people that are dominated by Prevotella, people that are dominated by Ruminococcus, people that are dominated by Bacteroides. And the argument was is that you could group people like blood type, that everybody fit into one of these three groups. Turns out it's horseshit, okay? But it's interesting. But Prevotella is a primary genus in the American gut. You'll have some people that have huge amounts of it. People that live in Burkina Faso, there's a paper published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences a couple years ago. It's the most cited paper in that journal ever. And this group was dominated by Prevotella. Some of the people had 90% of all the bacteria in their gut were Prevotella. What did they eat? Grains. Okay, but at the time, it was referred to as a rural African village, okay? So this was somehow ancestral. But they ate very little vegetables, if you will, had very little access to meat, and mainly had a grain-based diet, huge levels of Prevotella. So it was thought for a long time, and it still is by a lot of people, that Prevotella is somehow ancestral, for the lack of a better word, somehow ancestral. And then we're going to talk about Prevotella again in a minute. It's often been associated with people who eat high-fiber diets. People on a high-fiber diet have lots of Prevotella. Not the case, okay? So, again, important, but we see the impact of corn on people's Prevotella and other important bacteria. Again, I'm going to move along real quickly here. This is really fascinating. This was a graduate student in Rob Knight's lab. Looked at different, these are poo samples. Again, closer the dot together, the more similar the microbiomes, the farther the more dissimilar. So on the right-hand side, we see yellow, that's a bunch of American poop. Green, we've got Malawi and Venezuela. They look different. We've got some orange up there, which is Italians. God knows we know they're different. And then up on the left-hand side, we have some Hadza that look more like wild vervet monkeys. Okay, vervet monkeys are tasty, by the way. Interesting. This is some of the research group. I don't know what that guy's doing in there. This guy, this is a Datoga. There's Marty Blazer. This is Peter Imch from the Imch Foundation, who's a huge supporter of our group. I think it's the first time he ever been camping. That was fun. There's Maria Gloria. This is a local nurse. This is Dowdy Peterson, who runs Durobo Safaris, who's been, we couldn't do our project without him. There's Taryn. There's some Hadza. There's wives. There's Rob Knight. There's me, all shirtless, and some other Hadza people. So it takes a village. Again, I talked about this last year. I'll talk about it briefly. For those of you that didn't hear this last year, one of the things I wanted to know what does the microbiome look like of the Hadza free-living hunter-gatherer population compared to people in Burlington, Vermont? But one of the questions I wanted to know is why do I have, when we know that the Hadza hunter-gatherers have twice as many bacteria as everybody on average of everybody in this room, why is that? Why do they have so much diversity? We know diversity is a good thing. Any ecosystem that has diversity, like monoculture and non-monoculture, is a good thing. And there's a paradigm move, or paradigm shift, that if we can increase diversity in our guts, we may attenuate or improve our health. So a lack of diversity is associated with obesity. That's actually been proven. It's not, the obesity doesn't cause it, but we now know that you can take a not very diverse microbiome from an obese mouse and put it into a germ-free mouse and take a microbiome that's more diverse, let's say from a thin mouse, and put it in a germ-free mouse, feed them the exact same thing, and you can transfer the obesity phenotype into make the other mouse fat just by transferring the microbes and not changing the food. And so we now know there's a relationship between diversity and composition of your bacteria and your susceptibility to obesity and a bunch of other things. So one of the things I wanted to know personally was my daughter's type 1 diabetes. Did it have to do with her lack of diversity as a child? Did she take too many antibiotics? She was born C-section. She was only breastfed 6 months. Wet wiped to death. You know, that's the world we lived in. And it's the world we still live in. And was it have something to do with her diversity? And where did her diversity go? Are we responsible for that as a society and as parents and so on and so forth? So every time I go to Africa, I collect my poo before I leave. I collect my poo when I'm there. And I collect my poo when I'm come home. Okay? And so one of the things I did the first time I went to Africa, we lived with the Hadza, but we ate our Western food. You know, we had our vegetables and our pasta and our whiskey and all our own stuff, okay? Our own marijuana, took our own stuff, okay? So all our own Western stuff. Just kidding about the marijuana, kind of. Anyway, so then I measured just being in the environment, could I change my microbiome, okay? And I don't have that slide here, but yes, it changes, okay? Because I'm accumulating new microbes. No great mystery there. Next time I went back, I was in the Hadza land, but this time I ate Hadza food, okay, baobab fruit, zebra. I dropped the Western food, all right? So I just ate their food. But I lived in my camp, okay? My fire, my tent, my Land Cruiser, but their food, okay? So over the course of a couple of days, my microbiome shifts even more, okay? And I'm drinking their water and so on and so forth, okay? So next step could, you know, should I live with them for a month? Move out of my tent, move into a grass hut? Am I really going to learn a lot more? So I need to take it to another level. So enter turkey baster. Okay, so what I did at the time was I took the feces of a hunter-gatherer male, 35 years of age. We knew which bacteria he had in his body. Taryn and I did a bunch of rapid field tests for HIV over and over and over and over and over. We had him tested for Hep A, B, and C. I didn't know the parasites he had. We didn't have the data back at the time, but I didn't care. So I had him poo in a bowl for me, quite confusingly. He gave permission, gave me the bowl. It was really funny when he came over and gave me the, because I needed to immediately get it in my body. He gave me the Tupperware bowl. I'm like, okay, see you later. And he's standing there. He didn't want to leave. He wanted to see what I was going to do with it, even after I explained it to him. So anyway, put it in solution, pull in the turkey baster, and then lubed it up with some organic lube and shoved it up my wahoo, okay? Squirted away, did that twice, laid on my back with the feet up in the air for an hour, pedaling an imaginary bike, and did the world's first fecal transplant with a hunter-gatherer. So, and at that, so anyway, don't advise it. So every researcher I asked about this before I did it said, don't do it, but it will be fascinating. Because they can't say to do it. There's nothing ethical about it whatsoever. But it was the next step for me, and it's a personal step. So what I wanted to do was, I didn't want his microbiome, because I think he possesses some great mix of bacteria that's going to make my freckles fall off and my hair turn brown again. Okay, I wanted to acquire his diversity so I could destroy it. So at that moment in time, when I acquired his microbiome, which I did, by the way, we now know that. We haven't published the data yet, so I can't go into detail. But I did acquire his microbiome. And then before doing the fecal transplant, before laying on my back, it was very emotional, too, to go through the whole process. Before laying on my back and doing that, I'd kind of eaten a little bit of a Hadza diet for a while. But the minute I went back to camp, got around the fire about 7 or 8 o'clock that night, you know, and everybody's like, did you do it? Yeah, I did it. And then I grabbed a glass of whiskey and immediately started trying to kill it. I was able to hold the fecal transplant in my body till 11 o'clock the next morning, allowing it to populate my distal colon. And then I had my first bowel movement, and then, of course, took a sample. So, of course, we took samples of the sample that he gave me and samples of me before I took the sample, okay, before, during, and after. Also took blood. Okay, as well. We took blood, urine, and feces. That's my sample right before I did the fecal transplant. This is my blood on the left. This is my good stuff, and then that's the urine. Okay, I want to know how it changed my blood, how it changed, you know, biomarkers of inflammation possibly in my urine, and so on and so forth. All very interesting, by the way. So anyway, so I did this, and then took samples afterward, took the whiskey, and then started eating pasta again, and started I went back to a Western diet. I tried to kill everything that I possibly could. Transferred back to the United States, took some samples afterwards, went back onto my regular diet of whatever the hell, okay? And so the point is when I go back to Africa, which I haven't done since I talked here last, we didn't go back to Africa, we were in Namibia instead of Tanzania this January, I'll go back onto a Hadza diet. If I can destroy some of those, let's say he had 1,200 species of bacteria, or OTUs, if I acquired them, did I blunt it down to 600 or 700, and can I get them to rebloom back up just by going to the environment again? And if they don't bloom back up, that's fascinating, because my Western diet caused mass extinction, which is what we represent today. Okay, so what I was trying to do, if you squint a little bit, was recreate all of these epidemiological transitions that have happened over, with a sample size of one, which is meaningless, by the way. Sample size of one is meaningless. So I just wanted to see, for my own personal edification, if you will, if I could go through this process. And if I did, and I go back again and try to get them to rebloom, if they all bloom back up, that's fascinating. If they don't bloom back up, that's fascinating. It's hard to lose, so to speak. Based on that information, I'll probably do another experiment and another experiment. Next thing you know, 10 years from now, it leads to something interesting and important. Yes, sir? That's a good question. Yeah, I don't think it's muscle memory as it is nutrients and co-association, you know, things like that. Because bacteria not only feed directly on nutrients you provide them, they also feed on cross-feed through byproducts produced by other bacteria and stuff. But that's a great question. But, yeah, that's a rough analogy of kind of how it all works. Yes, ma'am.
How does
Huge. It's a great question. Parasites, because they modulate and control, they affect immunity, your immune system considerably, have a major impact, and it's one area that's horribly understudied. But we study the parasites as well. So we see people have certain parasites, no parasites. Does that somehow condition the composition of the microbiome? Great question. Yeah, it's overlooked with a lot of Western studies because we all assume not to have parasites.
What about in the air, just breathing?
Yeah, absolutely. I forget the number, so I'm going to make this up, but it'll be, you'll get the idea. A cubic foot of air or a cubic meter of air has millions and millions of bacteria in it. So every time you breathe, you're sucking that in. So we're all sharing microbes right now. We're one big family. Yeah, there's no way to quantify it, so it's meaningless. Doesn't mean anything. My flatulence reduced, and I lost 13 pounds, just like that. But then I gained it back. All right, so what, yes, ma'am. Yes. Okay. We're publishing it pretty soon. So it took really well. And it's more interesting than I could have imagined. But I highly advise it. And I took a lot of shit for it, pun intended. I'd say 80% of the scientific community was against it. The other 20% think I should win a Nobel Prize. So I don't care either way. I did it for myself. I didn't do it as part of the collaboration. I did it for my own edification. It's part of my learning process and what I want to try to understand to try to get to the point where I think I can make a difference. Yeah, no, fecal transplant's amazing. I mean, it's the, FMT, fecal microbiota transplant's the new black. I mean, it is. It's now great for C. diff, so now they're exploring, if you have a Clostridium difficile infection, it's great for clearing that, which kills a lot of people, makes life hell on earth, if you will. You literally shit yourself to death. But now they're exploring IBS and other things. The problem is the journalists oversell it a little too much, and the public overhopes a little too much on it. There's a long way to go on fecal transplants. At the end of the day, reasonable people will tell you that you're better off nudging your microbiome with diet and other lifestyle factors than you are doing ecosystem restorations because there's so many unknowns and it's really, really can be complicated, could be bad. But right now it works for C. diff. It's miraculous, but it's not a cure-all for, like I said, freckles and balding and all that other kind of stuff. What they do, that's another problem. So they take a healthy donor that has some relationship or not to the sick individual, and they put the healthy donor's stool into that individual. Sometimes you have to do it multiple times. So now they're setting up banks. Okay, I forget the name of it. Maybe you guys, there's nonprofit banks that collect stool samples from healthy people and supply them to hospitals now. So they're trying to, so if you get a really healthy person like you, it's almost like the Henrietta Slacks or Henrietta Lacks thing, So anyway, so over the next 10 or 15 years, you're probably going to see it in a probiotic because somebody's going to figure out how to make a lot of money off of it. I'm going to move really quickly through the rest of these. So spending a lot of time in Tanzania, and we also now work in Botswana, Namibia, and some other places and so on and so forth, you sit around long enough, you sit around enough fires, you get enough dirt on you, you look at enough little kids with little bloated bellies, so it's not malnourishment, by the way. And so you start to, it all kind of comes together. It starts to make a lot of sense. You can't really think about it when you're in a lab, when you're separated from the people and you watch them interact and you watch what happens. Probably the most profound thing that I discovered working with hunter-gatherers now, and a lot of people that think along these lines would agree with it, is the breathtaking, not only interaction they have with the microbial world, but the extraordinary amount of dietary fiber that they eat. Okay? A 9-month-old child could eat as much as 50 to 200 grams of fiber a day, mainly through baobab, okay? So when they begin to wean the children, they take baobab, which we'll talk about in a minute, and they give it to the child. So if you look at the USDA recommendations, the problem with fiber is, as I mentioned last year, it's just not sexy. It's what grandma put in the glass and stirred, okay? It was Metamucil, okay? But the problem is fiber's not sexy because most of us don't like fiber because we associate it with that cracker that, I call it the Ezekiel, the Jesus bread. It's like you got to really choke that stuff down and stuff. So it's just not fun to eat a lot of fiber, okay? But I think that's changing, okay? But the problem is the USDA, oh, by the way, this is great. You guys know every 5 years that the Dietary Guidelines for Americans are revised by an expert committee. This last one was 13 well-respected researchers. You know, they were epidemiologists, medical doctors, or whatever, and not a single microbiologist in the group, okay? There's thousands and thousands of articles, not necessarily related to diet, but all of it, if you think about it hard enough, you can put it on a table and start stacking them in piles and stuff. Not a single expert on the panel was a microbiologist or microbial ecologist. I do it every 5 years. I get the PDF, and this one's like 700 pages long, and I put in the search, microbiome, microbiota. And that 700-page report that just came out, the word microbiome is mentioned twice. Okay, the first mention is this. I can't even remember the original quote, but it said something like this. The committee considered the role of the microbiome in the health and well-being of Americans, and we decided there wasn't enough literature to conclude it in our considerations. I didn't make that up. It's on my blog and it's on my website. Couldn't believe it. So it's breathtaking to me that we've spent hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars on the microbiome. Some of the smartest people in the world are working on this. Again, early days, long way to go, but there's some basic things that we know which are not controversial among the scientists, and one of them is dietary fiber. So, one of the things, real quickly, this little kid, that's from fermentation. Okay, a lot of people misinterpret that as malnutrition, it's cachoir, but it's not. It's fermentation. This kid is woofing down the dietary fiber, and consequently the fiber transfers to the gut, then with the bacteria ferment it, and then you get distension, okay? This is what all hunter-gatherer babies look like, all of them, and they've always looked that way because baobab grows all over Africa. It's the primary weaning food in Africa, and there's no reason to believe it hasn't always been. It's everywhere. It occurs 11 months out of the year. It's easy to process. You put it in water. The kid can drink it. It's just like formula. And that's why they do it. They mix a little honey in with it, so on and so forth. Now they're using corn. So anyway, so we're going to do a little quick thing on dietary fiber. Again, it's the most profound thing that I've learned working with the hunter-gatherers is the amount of fiber that they eat. And this is interesting. U.S. Dietary Guidelines doesn't even make recommendations for kids under the age of 2. And it turns out, we're now learning that from a microbial standpoint, that the dye might be cast with regards to your microbes for age 2 and under. So there is no emphasis on fiber consumption for children, but we now see that when you look at a Hadza baby or even a child, a small child, they'll eat 50, 100, 150, 200 grams, 300 grams of fiber, 500 grams of fiber. It fluctuates daily, weekly, monthly. But fiber is a huge part of their diet. So they're getting an extraordinary amount of calories from fermentation. And we'll talk about it in a minute. And so they have very acidic colons. Acidity is very good for suppressing pathogens. Acidity is also very good for shutting down, increasing barrier function. So you don't have a leaky gut on the colon end. Okay. And so on and so forth. So if you sit back and think about it for a minute, get underneath the baobab tree, sit around a fire, smoke some really bad marijuana, and think about it for a minute, and you realize that kids actually eat more fiber than adults, which is the exact opposite of what our dietary guidelines are. So as the kid gets older, they start to eat more meat, more honey, and then by the time a boy is 8 or 10, he's on his own. Think about that for a minute. He's out collecting his own, getting 80, 90% of his own calories on his own. So as you get older and you start to introduce other foods, the fiber consumption actually goes down just a little bit. Okay, we haven't quantified this yet because nobody's ever even thought about it. It's very difficult to do to follow kids around all day trying to figure out how much fiber they're eating, but we're going to do it, and we haven't done it yet, but we're going to try to do it soon. So anyway, this is an 800-pound wicker gorilla in the room, if you will, is this fiber concept. Anyway, carbohydrates for gut microfermentation can come from a variety of sources. Dietary host-derived animal glycans, for example, there is fiber in meat, very small amounts. Some of it gets undigested, ends up in the colon. Your intestinal tract provides some dietary sources for the bacteria as well, because you're always fluffing off cells and so on and so forth. So that ends up in the colon where the bacteria ferment it. They're just sitting down there waiting for it. And then the primary source of nutrients is dietary plant material, okay? You know, bacteria eat fiber, okay? That's what they do, and that's how they survive, okay? So the primary fiber sources, again, for the Hadza, are tubers, okay? We now know that women probably eat more fiber than men, and babies eat more than everybody, or children and babies. This is a canola bee. This is a berry. If you walk around with a Hadza any length of time, these bushes are everywhere. They're all over East Africa and Southern Africa. They just pick these berries. There's nothing in them. It's just fiber. And they suck on them and spit the seeds out, okay? So they're eating fiber all day long. Even the men, when they're hunting, they're eating these. The men are also eating roots all day. Okay, and during certain seasons of the year, during the wet season, These are the Cordova, I can't remember the name of these berries, but berries provide another source of fiber. But mainly these tubers, okay, they eat them nonstop, but there's so much fiber in them that they chew and they spit out the quid, okay? So trying to quantify that's difficult as well. But anyway, they eat fiber all the time. Even if they drop a kudu, big, large animal, and they gorge on meat, they continue to eat fiber, okay? One of the things that you'll see in microbial studies, you guys have seen it, TMAO, okay? Okay, it's associated with heart disease and stuff, and it's produced by bacteria and stuff. Every time a microbiologist, every time you see a paper that says high-fat diets are our animal-based American diet, okay, promotes the growth of certain bacteria, they always feed mice these high-fat diets, but they don't give them any fiber at the same time. Turns out if you eat as much protein and fat as you want, but also include fiber in it at the same time, you don't have the same reactions. But microbiologists are looking for extreme reactions. So anytime I see that kind of stuff, you always got to look at how much fiber is being introduced. With very few of us just eat fat and protein all day, okay, except if you're on these running really low carb diets and you eschew everything. So, but the Hadza, even when they're gorging on meat, continue to eat lots of fiber. Again, baobab trees, which is this fruit over here, provides these little things inside that when this nice lady pounds them out, ends up with fiber and fat. So it tastes like a pecan. There's a nut on the inside. Huge amounts of fat, extraordinary amounts of dietary fiber. Again, the few times that I've quantified it when I first went out there, I saw a Hadza male eating about 400 to 500 grams of fiber a day for the days that I followed him. Average American eats 16 to 18. Okay, and we think getting 25 is a big deal. Okay. So again, real quickly, this is stuff that you guys know. Again, when the plants go into the intestine or the cake goes in the intestine, the cake, there's no food for the bacteria. There's no dietary fiber, okay? But what happens is the bacteria ferment it. They create things like short-chain fatty acids and other metabolites that are converted into energy, energy not only for the colonic wall but also for you as well. But more importantly, which is completely underemphasized by everybody, is it changes the acidity of the colon. Now, don't confuse that with blood pH and alkalinity. We have the most alkaline guts in human history right now, okay? If you do anything for yourself besides buy these books, is go to the drugstore and buy pH strips. Start checking the pH of your stool sample every single time you go to the bathroom, okay? If it's not below neutral, if it's not in the 4, 5, 6 range, you need to start eating more plants. You need more fermentation. It is, I would argue, as diagnostic or more diagnostic as a blood or a urine test with regards to your overall health and well-being. Because when you create an acidic colonic environment, okay, you improve the health of it, you blunt pathogens. Pathogens don't like acidity. So some of them become more acidic tolerant, okay, and you improve barrier function. Nothing leaks into the gut. No lipopolysaccharides, no LPB, no low-grade inflammation. Because when things leak into the gut through that screwed-up colonic wall, it's because you have an alkaline gut. Alkaline distal gut. And so this, I would argue, would be the most important thing you do. And just for fun, if anybody wants to follow the Human Food Project on Facebook, which is annoying, but I have to use it because it's important, if you guys do it, it'd be fun if people would post their results. Say, okay, I took pH strips Monday through Friday. This is what it looked like. I started eating more lentils or more this, whatever, and I watched it change. It's super empowering to watch your pH change, okay? So you stick it in the poo, it takes a minute, you got to hold it upside down, get the water, the moisture to run down on it, but you can change it overnight. Keep it around 4 or 5, call it good. If it's 8 or 9, you got a problem. Yes, ma'am. No, it's into the bloodstream, yeah. Yeah, across that barrier. That barrier is not supposed to, it's supposed to transport nutrients and other things, but not some metabolites and some byproducts of the bacteria. So anyway, if you take 1,000 species of bacteria, okay, they encode about 60,000 carbohydrate-degrading enzymes. Okay, so the bacteria in your gut encode 60,000 different enzymes to break down carbohydrates. Your genome has a handful, okay? So these guys are doing all the work for you. Okay, so what's happened over time is, you know, microbial diversity went from hunter-gatherers, 10,000, depends on where you live, okay? Some people have remained hunter-gatherers, obviously. But more or less on average, as we move into agriculture, industrial food, each one of these new technologies, each one of these epidemiological trends, crowding together, all these things have reduced the diversity. MAC, high MAC diet, is not Big Mac. That's a term coined by Justin and Erica Sonnenberg. That's microbial available carbohydrates. It's a great term to start differentiating between soluble and insoluble and all these crazy terms that none of us can even keep track of anyway. It's very difficult. But what's happened over time, diet, sanitation, antibiotics, C-sections, we've reduced the diversity. Go to Africa, okay, reintroduce yourself to that meta community, your whole world changes again. So this isn't rocket science, it's harder. And so there's a lot of smart people working on this, but there are some things that can be done right now. And I would urge everybody in this room, if you're not eating 50 grams or more dietary, don't eat every day. Okay, the Hadza will gorge on honey, fructose, and glucose for weeks, which would drive a nutritionist crazy. And then if they kill a big animal, they'll eat pounds and pounds of meat, depending on who they have to share it with, and organ meat and all this stuff, they gorge. But they also change your diet seasonally, okay? So there's this whole idea of three hots and a cod, or three square meals a day and stuff. It's okay to move it around and stuff, but you should always, no matter what you eat, eat as much dietary fiber with that meal or that day or within that period of 2 days or whatever that you can. I would argue, and I think you're going to see in the next couple of years, it will become the primary macronutrient that's discussed and becomes most important. I think it trumps fat, protein, and everything with regards. We know it does with regards to your microbial health, but systemically, it's probably tied to everything, which is tied to the microbes. So real quickly, bacteroids, when you look at 10,000 Americans like we have, okay, this graph kind of holds up at 4,000 or 6,000. The dominant species of bacteria in the American gut, when I say species, I mean genus, group of bacteria, is bacteroids. Don't get that confused with the phylum Bacteroides. Firmicutes and Bacteroides are phylum. Bacteroids is a genus. It's the dominant genus in the American gut and the European gut and the Australian gut and the Canadian gut. The Hadza don't have it. The argument in all the literature, take 100 of the last scientific papers published in Nature, Science, PNAS, whatever you want to do, and you will see where somebody talks about it. Bacteroids is representative of American diet, okay? High fat, high sugar, okay? But the Hadza, high fat, high sugar too. They'll gorge on honey, doesn't do anything to the bacteria. I mean, they have bacteroids, but it's really tiny, tiny amounts, okay? They'll gorge on honey, doesn't do anything to the bacteroids. They'll gorge on fat, doesn't do anything to the bacteroids, okay? I can take, so I showed this graph last year. I apologize you can't read all this gibberish, but trust me when I say that this is bacteroids in my diet, okay? So I was living in New Orleans. Great diet, lots of fat. I'd eat steak every day, bacon, you know, it'd make Ben proud, doing all that stuff. And that's the blue, okay? This is the amount of bacteroids in my system. They were like 15%, okay? I eat tons of fiber. I eat leeks every day, onions. I had tons and tons of plants. I eat lentil, a couple lentils every day, 20, 30 grams of that. Lots of fiber. When I moved out to Terlingua in West Texas to that little dusty town that I now call home, my diet changed. And so I ate most of my meals at the beer joint. Okay, and it was usually at a bar with a glass of tequila because that's all you could eat out there. So I went out there to work. And so basically I stopped eating fiber because there's no fiber in a beer joint. You know, it's hamburgers and french fries and shit, lots of fat. So I continued my fat and protein, but I dropped my fiber. My bacteroids shot up to 55%, just like that. That, by the way, was happened in 48 hours. Okay, so the point being is the dominant bacteria and the American gut is bacteroids. Now, there are good bacteroids, Bacteroides fragilis, which has been associated it's an anti-inflammatory bacteria. It's now being linked to autism, a couple other things, a positive link, okay? And so bacteroids, which have been argued to be the result of a high-fat diet, you see this, I saw it in a paper last week, you know, bacteroids are associated with American diet unless you include fiber. The problem is they do these studies, but they don't include the fiber. So you can have your meat, if you will, so long as it includes the asparagus. So that's not complicated, okay? So the Hadza gorge on organ meat, lots of fat, but they have their fiber too. So they blunt bacteroids down. Okay, so I'm wrapping up here. So in addition to the Hadza, Taryn and I were in Namibia in January. We're setting up a project down there, which we've sampled Himba houses before. So we're also interested in the houses everybody lives in too. So we sample the houses. We work with Rob Dunn at North Carolina State University and the Sloan Foundation on understanding the microbiome of the houses. You're going to see more and more of that now, the microbiome of hospitals, microbiomes of homes. So you're going to see with the next 10 to 20 years that homes and commercial buildings will be designed with the microbiome of the building in mind. That means more circulation, less filtering, more plant life, possibly goats in the hallways. Who knows? Okay? There's already jackasses in the hallways. Why not goats? So anyway, so the Himba in Namibia, if anybody's ever been down there, interesting people, they're pastoralists, okay? They are not hunter-gatherers. They have intimate association with donkeys, cows, and goats, and we're setting up a project to study them. We have groups in the Sossusvlei Valley. Help me? Anyway, up by, okay, up in the Angola border. So anyway, we have a group of Himba that live in the mountains that don't have any antibiotics. We have a group of Himba that live in town. They both have cows and stuff, but no antibiotics. So we're going to study antibiotics down there. Here's some Himba kids. I was the first white man these Himba kids ever saw, okay, by the way. And you know that, too, because they run from you. They don't run to you with their hand out. They run from you, okay? This is a San Bushman. We're putting together an intervention project in Namibia. San Bushmen are fully acculturated, okay? They're no longer, it's illegal for a San Bushman to hunt, by the way. Be thrown in jail. Except if you're in the Nai Nai Conservancy, you can still hunt. So we have a group of San Bushmen that sit around. When the tourists show up, they put on the skins, okay, hide the Coca-Cola, so on and so forth. So what we're going to do is take a group of San Bushmen, take them out in the bush for 14 days, revert them to their ancestral diet or their natural diet, and see what happens. Okay? So we're working out there as well. We just got back from Mongolia. Anybody that's ever been out there, it is not a culinary hotspot. So this is Ulaanbaatar, which is the capital. Taryn and I were in January with some other colleagues. We ended up in this area. To get there is hell on Russian wheels. So fly into Ulaanbaatar, 18 hours in a Russian four-wheel drive in a snowstorm. We'll get your juices going. And so you end up in a little town over in here. You take another bad Russian four-wheel drive van that's about as comfortable as riding on a baseball bat. Okay. Across the tundra, the streams we shouldn't cross, all that kind of stuff. You end up somewhere where you then get on a horse and it's snowing, and the snow is blowing in your face. I'm like, really? What am I doing here? I don't like cold weather. But we're after these guys, and these guys are interesting. So after you do all this travel, you end up on a horse. I was telling David yesterday that it was so amazing. It was one of the coolest things that ever happened. I'm on the horseback, you know, and I'm freezing to death. I'm like, what am I doing? And we don't have any alcohol. There's no weed. There's nothing here up here. These people don't do anything cool. And so we're up there, and I look up, and there's a guy riding a reindeer. It was the most surreal thing. So anyway, this is a shaman. So we ended up with the reindeer people. These guys live up by the last nomadic reindeer herders in Mongolia. They're originally from Russia. There's reindeer herders in Russia and, of course, in Scandinavia and a few other places. These guys live in teepees, just like Native Americans. And did I mention it's really cold up here? Okay. So these are some of the reindeer hunters. This is the night before we left to go up into the mountains on horseback. That tent doesn't work very well. There's a dog next to the teepee. There's us on horseback. We're going this way, up around the corner in the mountains. More horseback. There's Taryn with her fashionable hat. Everybody, look at the clothes that people are wearing. I mean, this doesn't do us justice, but it is cold, cold, cold. So we're not going back in the winter. Gets to negative 50. Reindeer. Okay, why we're interested in these guys is they don't eat any dietary fiber. Okay? These guys eat reindeer meat. They eat milk. They drink milk tea, which is gross. They're super nice people. Super nice people, amazing people. And they eat bread. Okay, so what they do is the government gives them the equivalent of $60 a month for the males, which they started doing 2 or 3 years ago. And they go to town on the reindeer. And some of them have motorcycles. Okay, they bought motorcycles with their money. And they get bread. So these guys make some really bad bread. And they have milk tea with reindeer milk, and they eat reindeer. And then sometimes they'll buy mutton and some other things. They don't eat plants other than the grains used to make the whatever. There's no fiber in it. These guys eat no fiber, except in August. In August, some berries pop out. It's cold in this place. And so there's the berries pop out in August, but they're not enthusiastic about it, I'm told. We happened to run into a researcher living in a teepee when we got there, which was fabulous. She knew everything about the reindeer people. So I'm interested in them, not because they have a motorcycle, it means they're not good to study and all this other kind of stuff. I'm interested they don't have any fiber in their diet, okay? So we went there to do some reconnaissance, to find them, figure out how to get liquid nitrogen, meet with collaborators at Mongolia State University, do all that kind of stuff. And then I suspect these guys will have horrific microbiomes. that we would consider horrific by Western standards. But it may be fine for him. Oldest individual we found was 63, but it's a tough life, okay? So we expect these microbiomes, we expect these people to be constipated, and we expect their microbiomes not to have lots of bacteroids.
And not much diversity.
And not much diversity, correct. Except for, it's a good question, except they still live in the environment, so to speak, but it's a cold environment. So microbes in the environment are controlled by pH and temperature and moisture and things like this. So we're not studying these guys because they're a perfect paleo referent or anything else. They just don't eat fiber. So, and I don't dislike cold weather, so it's either go see the Inuit or these guys. So these guys seem more reasonable. And so, plus there's reindeer, so. Don't know. Nobody's ever asked. We're gonna find out. Here's the shaman's wife. It's a shaman culture. You can't sleep a certain direction in the bed. We slept in teepees. You can't do certain things around the fire. We violated all of that. And so I'm probably going to shaman hell, whatever that is. Here's, again, each family has 20 to 30 reindeer. Here's some reindeer meat. Again, the teepee, cold-ass mountains in the distance. Again, lots of fat. That's a good thing. Lovely lady, she let us stay in her teepee. That cost us $20. Modern world is there, okay? But I don't care. It doesn't matter. I'm not studying their propensity to watch the Kardashians. What I want to know is, and there's a motorcycle, they just don't eat fiber, so... And so we'll sample the reindeer, we'll sample the environment, the water, the teepees. I can't remember. I think they have CB radios and stuff, and I think they might get HBO out there. I don't know. I didn't see HBO. Anyway, so there's a couple projects around the world. There's two more slides and we're done. You guys can leave and we'll see you next year. But there's a lot of projects around the world. I say a lot, a few. Maria Gloria Dominguez Bello working in South America. You may have saw the report a month or two ago. Most diverse microbiome in the world. Found a Yanomamo in South America. That was Maria Gloria. She works with me in Africa, and her husband, Marty Blazer, and all those other people are part of our team as well. So they about, I don't know, this is weird, 8-9 years ago, there was a Venezuelan helicopter that flew over an contacted group. You guys seen the pictures with them shooting at the helicopters and stuff. One of those kinds of incidents. Anyway, the medical crew went in there, and they collected poo samples from 11 individuals, a completely uncontacted group, okay? So fascinating stuff. So when you look at, again, same drill. United States, this is diversity of bacteria in their gut. United States has low diversity. Malawi, okay. Malawi is a crappy diet, super crappy diet. These are just poor people living in Malawi. But they have greater diversity because they're in closer contact with soil, dirty water, animals, so on and so forth. Horrific diet. It's usually a pretty terrible diet, usually grain-based. But they have more diversity because of the environment, okay. This is a group in Venezuela that Maria Gloria works with, and here's the uncontacted Mount Yanomamo. All the news headlines said most diverse set of bacteria in the world, okay? We haven't published the Hadza stuff, the big Hadza study yet, but we have the most diverse, but who cares? You're talking about a little bit more. But what's interesting is that the more westernized we become, the less diverse we become. So you can't blame it on one particular thing, okay? You can't blame it on one particular thing. It's everything. And this is actually a photo, that's not the uncontacted village. One of these is the actual, that might have been these guys right here that they took poo from, and nobody got stuck with an arrow. Okay, that's not Albert Einstein. That's our friend Greg, okay? And yes, we were lost. So, but anyway, where do we go from here, okay? How do we wrap this up? What's the take-home message? Okay, other than me not divulging a lot of information about my fecal transplant, other than it worked, and you can read about it if you follow along, okay? But the take-home message continues to be the same for me, and it gets stronger every month as we look at this data and stuff. You know, I listen to Ben. I love Ben. He's great. He's an incredibly smart guy, and he knows the literature better than any human being I've ever run across and stuff like that. But you know what? It's not that complicated when it comes to microbes, okay? You can slice it six ways to Sunday. It's that classic you can't see the forest for the trees thing. And so just like car people, you know, you could go to the mechanic 30 years ago, 40 years ago, I just dated myself, you know, and the guy went there and he had the overalls on, he's got the tobacco coming down his lip or whatever, he could fix the muffler, the carburetor, the engine, your seatbelt, give you a fake sticker, whatever you needed. It was one-stop shopping. Now you go, the guy's like, well, I don't work on mufflers, you know, I don't do transmissions. You got to go transmission guy, you got an engine guy, so there's specialties. Everybody's got a specialty. It's been, okay, and that's what microbiology does too. Everybody thinks microbiologists study diet. You can count on one hand the number of microbiologists that study the impact of diet. Okay? They all have different specialties. You know, working on immunity, they're working on leaky guts, they're working on whatever. They're all working to get patents to get their university money, by the way. Otherwise, they're going to lose their job. Okay? They're after actionable things that can be patented and make money so they can keep their job. Okay? And so, or make more money and so on and so forth. But they're doing a lot of good and it's important. But the more I sit around the baobab trees and the fire, the more people I visit around the world, and I read the literature, I've got tens of thousands of PDFs. I'm not a microbiologist, and I didn't stay at a Holiday Inn last night, okay? I'm not a professor at a university. I'm not a science writer, okay, because I didn't want to pay the $100 you had to pay to the National Association of Science Writers to get the I'm a science writer thing. I'm just a guy who had a sick daughter, okay, who has a background in anthropology, who spent a lot of time now in Africa, who I now rub up against probably some of the smartest people in the world, and I'm honored to be around them, put together some amazing projects, cobbled together funds from various places, my own, and we've raised some money from some wonderful people doing things to buy diesel and refried beans, and they don't pay for the whiskey and the marijuana, but they buy everything else, and done all this stuff. And by creating these collaborations and sitting around those fires, you start to see the dots connect. And it's not an understatement to say the single most important thing you can do for your microbiome is increase the quantity and diversity. We've seen how diversity of plants increases diversity of microbiome. We see how living more rural or less modern affects your microbiome. It's not that complicated, okay? It's not that complicated. You don't have to take a pill. You don't have to do anything. You just need to eat more fiber, okay? And eat it any way you can. I don't care how you, if you got to chew on the chair at home. I don't care. Just eat more fiber and get your kids to eat it, okay? And all the other issues around birthing methanol, those are all important variables. But dietary fiber, and it seems too simple, and it probably is. But we do know that you can have positive responses. And get outside, spend some more time outside, get to Shelburne Farms, go kiss a cow, do whatever you got to do before you leave, touch Doug, you know, whatever. But Doug's been on, he's been on udders since 4:30 this morning, probably not a bad guy to shake hands with. And so, you know, can petting a cow make you healthier? Who knows? Can being outside make you feel better, make your microbiome feel better? Probably, okay? Antimicrobial soaps. The big boogeyman I think that's going on in the system right now, which Marty Blaser is calling out on antibiotics and everybody agrees, is our national water supply. That is the one that's going to knock us right up against the side of the head in the next 5 to 10 years with research. We're going to probably find that the chlorine, not the fluoride, but the chlorine that doesn't evaporate by the time it hits your tap has a major impact on your gut microbiome because chlorine kills bacteria. That's why it's in the water in the first place. So the unintended consequence of reducing the microbial load of the public water supply, just like antibiotics, may be impacting our microbiome in the same way. And we've all seen the little graphs starting post-World War II. Now that we're in the Anthropocene era, you know, you can plot, you know, the incidence of televisions in the house and obesity, indoor plumbing and obesity, the amount of Kardashian episodes and obesity, whatever it is, IBS, IBD, you can plot the chlorine in the water with it too. But we know chlorine impacts bacteria. So that's why at home we have Berkey's. I don't use it as often as I should. Taryn uses it a little bit more religiously than I do. But trying to figure out how to get the chlorine, if you can, buy those filters. And we live in Terlingua where they put so much chlorine in the water that I could do my whites in the sink, okay? You know, you put it outside and let it evaporate off. So thinking about those kinds of things, but most importantly, start thinking about your microbiome. Like I said last year, it's about ecosystem management. We spend a lot of time yelling about it in the environment and screaming at oil companies and monoculture people and stuff like that, but we have the most diverse ecosystem in the world in our guts, and it's the most important one to us. And so we need to start paying attention to it the same way we do everything else. And so I'm going to shake the tin cup here a little bit before I leave. One of the things that we did at Human Food Project is we started a fundraising bar, okay? It's a damn nutrition bar. It's not going to make your freckles fall off and make your hair turn brown again and make you live longer, but it may make you live longer, okay? All we did here was we do everything creative we can to raise money because if I could spend 365 days a year in Africa, I would. But it takes money, okay? We raise money from people. We raise money from organizations. We start a nonprofit. We've gotten grants from people. But this was an easy way. There's 140,000 people that get the Human Food Project newsletter, okay, that all opted in. So we create a little bar. It's got stuff in it we like to eat, that Taryn and I like to eat and everybody else, all these kind of things. But we put organic agave powder. It's not agave nectar, It's agave powder. It's a special prebiotic. It's a beta-2-1 fructin with branch linear structure. That's the kind of stuff Ben talks about. And so, so this particular bar has 9 grams of fiber in it. It's not going to save your life, you know. It's got 190 calories in it, but what it will do, if you eat one, it'll promote the growth of bacteria and probably improve diversity. So I would encourage everybody, if you don't mind, we need the money, go to Human Food Bar, okay? Buy a box of it. If you don't like it, email me and yell at me, okay? But one thing I would like you to do, if anybody goes to humanfoodbar.com and buys this, do me a favor, okay? I guarantee nobody in this room eats 6 grams of prebiotic fiber. Now, prebiotics occur in onions, garlic, leek, bananas, things like that. They selectively stimulate. You hear that word all the time. Probiotic is a live organism. A prebiotic feeds certain bacteria. Happens to feed lactic acid bacteria. So do me a favor. If anybody in this room buys this product, and we hope you do, or buy it for your friend or family, makes great holiday gifts, and Christmas is just around the corner, is if you do buy it, okay, if you can, do your pH strips 2 or 3 days before you eat it, all right? And then there's 12 bars in a box. If you bought the bars individually in the store, they'd be $3 a piece or whatever. And now eat a bar for like 3 days in a row, one every morning, measure your pH, then don't eat a bar for 3 days. 3 days before, a bar each day for 3 days, 3 days after. Email me, post it on Facebook, whatever you got to do. Tell me if your pH changed, and more importantly, tell me if you didn't take the biggest shit of your life on the second day that you're eating the bar. Because those prebiotics, okay, 6 grams is a lot. It only takes 3 to 4 grams for a prebiotic effect or a bifogenic effect. Okay, they'll stimulate the growth of bacteria. Okay, bacteria is what your stool samples are. Okay, you'll notice a nice fluffy bowel movement, maybe even on the first or second day, okay? So just for fun, and this is the kind of fun I have, do that. pH, and did your bowel habit change? Now, if your flatulence increased, okay, I'm smiling all day long, okay? You should be having 15, 20, 30 flatulence a day with a couple of head turners in there. I'm not talking about uncomfortable gas. That's something different, okay? But I'm talking about, you know, good old farts, okay? That means you're fermenting, okay? So the more you ferment, the more likely you are you're going to have a nice bowel movement. So the bigger... Okay, Dennis Burkitt all taught us in the 1950s and 60s. He's the one-eyed British doctor who started the fiber craze. The bigger the bowel movements, the smaller the hospitals. Okay, so if any of you guys have that experience, or you don't, I'd like to know. But it all depends on your current levels of lactic acid bacteria. If you're really high already, it's not going to do anything. But I guarantee most people in this room don't eat. So it'd be fun, okay, and I would really appreciate the non-scientific feedback. On Facebook, if you hate the bar and it tastes like horse shit, email me privately. Because your individual taste might not. We started, it took us a year to put this project together. We used a third party group. Again, you're 99% microbe. It's time you start eating like it. That's a term you're going to see a lot more of. Nestle's moving that direction. Everybody's moving that direction. It's nutrition from the inside out. There's no artificial preservatives or freaky stuff any kind in it. Well, you heard us. Prebiotic fiber, it's gluten-free. Grain-free Hadza food has baobab flour in it. Okay, baobab is, you know, it's just fun. Okay, and that's why we put it in there. Part of the proceeds from this go to our research in Africa and support the Hadza Medical Fund as well to help Hadza who get sick, who need to go to the hospital, things like that. Now you have to go online to order them. So that's all I got.